Good morning. Welcome to the Sunday seminar. We are really, really excited about the program today. GNU Radio is one of the coolest pieces of software ever written, and it ties so directly into ham radio that it's hard to imagine a better fit. And we've for a long time wanted to have a training session so that more hams can become familiar with this software and start doing all the cool things it can do. And we're really blessed to have Tom Rondeau, KB3UKZ, as the speaker this morning. Tom is the leader of the GNU Radio Project and is herding all the cats who are developing this incredible software and using it for lots of really neat things. So Tom will be walking us through a live demonstration of how to use the software, how to actually build a radio using the tools. Now, most of you have already gotten, but if you haven't and want one, come to see me. We have a DVD that's a live Linux Ubuntu environment that you can put into your laptop, boot up, doesn't touch your hard disk at all, and has the GNU Radio software installed on it. So you can follow along with what Tom is doing as he's doing it, and you know, hands-on is the best way to learn. So we encourage you, all you have to do is set your laptop up so that it can boot from the optical drive, stick this in, reboot, and it should come up after quite a bit of grinding and chunking and worrying into an environment that's called actually Xubuntu. It runs a lightweight version of the desktop for the Ubuntu Linux system. So if you don't have a disk and want one, come see me. We have plenty. If you have a computer like a netbook that doesn't have a optical drive, if you have a jump drive, come and see me. I can put it on and make a bootable jump drive for you if you have the drive with you. And that'll let you play along as Tom does the presentation. So with that, Tom, welcome. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming here to be with us today, and good luck.
All right, so we have, does this sound okay? My voice tends to modulate itself higher and higher as I go on, so hopefully I don't drown everybody out. So we have 4 hours today to play with this. We'll take a break after a couple hours, let everybody get up, stretch your legs. As John said, if you guys want to play along, you know, get the live DVD, try to get it set up and booted. There'll be a few minutes as I go through the kind of necessary preliminary boring presentation part before we get to actually like do some hands-on stuff. So you have time to kind of get familiar and get the system up and running. So I'll begin, as I said, with the presentation part. 60 slides, but it's what I'm using this for us here is just to make sure we're all basically on the same playing field. So there's going to be some DSP, there's going to be some radio stuff that is probably going to bore you guys to tears because you're probably familiar with that aspect of it. But why I bring these things up when I give presentations, even to guys who have been doing radio and been doing communications for a long time, is again, first to make sure we are all talking the same language, but also to make sure to use it as a way to explore GNU Radio, because there are lots of tools, there are lots of techniques that are inside this big software package that we have, that I try to use these things to expose, to kind of break out and say, okay, you know, there's all sorts of really kind of fun, neat little things in here if you know how to access them. And that's a huge kind of issue with the project, is knowing how to access all of these things. So here's our list of things we're gonna go over. From the outline, from the abstract of this talk, you know, there's kind of like these three parts. Well, the first two parts are embedded here, intro to GNU Radio and some of the tools and filtering techniques. And then kind of the third part, that's really where we're gonna start trying to have some fun and kind of play along with some of the signal development systems that we have. I like to start off with this quote, because Shannon is undoubtedly one of the greatest geniuses of probably all time, especially our time. And this paper really did solidify what we're doing as a group. What are we trying to do, especially with digital communications? What is the basic fundamental thing that we're trying to do? And that's moving information around. So this kind of collapses in one sentence really what we're trying to do with GNU Radio, which is enable the ideas that came out of, you know, the past 100-ish years of this type of work. And if you haven't read that paper, I highly recommend it. One of the things I also love about Shannon is, and Turing too, if you've never read any of his stuff, they really had fun with what they were doing. You kind of tell in the way that they write their papers. They really loved what they were doing. And that's just, to me, it's always exciting to come across that type of you know, scientific paper writing. That's just my plug for him for what it's worth. So knowing that we're working on the physical layer, GNU Radio really is a physical layer piece of software. It branches into the Mac, but that's essentially where like the Mac layer, the data link layer is where you want to break out of the concept of GNU Radio and probably push it into the other world. So you can do some Mac layer concepts, but what we're really focusing on, what we're really trying to solve, is the physical layer issue. And every few years, this phrase is uttered by somebody: the physical layer is dead. And then you ask the question, well, what does that mean? Because if it was dead, why is it still so hard? And that's what we're trying to get to with GNU Radio. That's a huge part about the project. Is yes, we're close to the Shannon limit. You know, yes, we understand LDPC codes and turbo product codes and how to actually use this information theory to get us very close to the Shannon limit. We're still experimenting with things like, you know, MIMO channels and various kind of cutting edge stuff. A plug for our conference this week: we actually have a guy coming from Iowa who's talking about a distributed MIMO system that he's doing with GNU Radio, which I think is a really exciting concept. So there's still kind of fun things like that. But as far as like pure physical layer, you know, yeah, we have all these tools and techniques, but there's the theory and then there's the practice. And what GNU Radio is trying to do is bring a lot of that theory into everyday practice. How do you manipulate it? How do you combine techniques and ideas and algorithms? How do you implement algorithms in a way that solve physical, that create physical layer communication systems in ways that are flexible, are easy to use, are possibly dynamic? All of these things, it's using all of these tools that we've been building up that's still the hard part and what we're really hoping to solve. So that's what GNU Radio is trying to do for us, is kind of, it helps us with these four. There's probably more too that you could branch out here, but these are really what we're kind of all about. So there is the rapid prototyping, then there's the analysis development. You can go from idea through a production unit, and people have done this with GNU Radio. There are systems out there that are running this as production level code. But you can also start from a simulation to just kind of playing around with your ideas. The last two are important points to me. I come from, I have an academic background. I kind of still feel like I'm an academic in a lot of ways. I'm associated with the University of Pennsylvania now and you know, playing around with ideas like that. And so the idea of using this as an educational tool to me is huge, because you know, again, while we think we've solved the physical layer, we still have students coming out of school who don't understand receiver design. They don't understand the RF properties. Steven and I were talking about this just last night, about some of the fundamental flaws that people don't get exposed to when they're talking about when they're coming out of a college program. GNU Radio dives into it and gets you quickly operating over the air with all sorts of different ideas and different ways of playing with signals that start to really open up and expose what the problems are. And tips and tricks, this is my old Fred Harris, I learned from him. It's a neat trick. There are lots of neat tricks inside GNU Radio, many of which I learned from Fred, that we've put into it. And those are also really neat to see, how we're actually, you know, we're not just taking the math and throwing it into an algorithm. We actually have to work on the boundaries of computers, of hardware, of the realities of the radio systems and our interconnections, the buses, and all of those things have to be put into a system like this. So we have to think about this on multiple different levels in there. So we have a ton of things that GNU Radio kind of provides for us, and I'll kind of hit a lot of these one at a time once we get into it. So we'll see the first, you know, we'll go into what the scheduler is, we'll go into the collection of blocks. and the framework for using these tools, but also as mentioned, this that John kind of pointed out at the beginning, there's a community involved, and that's part of the open source kind of nature of a project, that we bring in a community of experts, enthusiasts, students who are just coming up from university, trying to get involved in these things. There's a huge layer of and kind of pool of resources that you draw on when you're like this. And of course, I'm talking to amateur radio guys. You know, it's the same thing with this, but it's coming from the CS community that you're trying to kind of work together and learn and build new things. And that goes into the open source licensing of GNU Radio. So it is a Free Software Foundation project. It's, you know, GPL licensed. And so, you know, you can take it and have at it and do what you will. So this is more for people later, and it's not too hard to find a lot of these things if you just, you know, use your favorite search engine and look for GNU Radio. But for anybody whose purposes can look at these various aspects, GNUradio.org, at this point, it's actually been over a year now that it's had a facelift that I think has really kind of opened it up, made it much easier to actually get into the project, because it was a little opaque for a while, and we're really trying to help people kind of get over that first hop. I don't think as a software project it is actually that complicated, but there definitely is that first hop over just to get a basic feel for what's going on. And I think once people actually have a basic understanding of what the scheduler is and how to look and use the various blocks that we have for signal processing, the rest of it is really kind of playing around, diving in, and it's a level of comfort. And that what we're trying to do is help get everybody started here with. So we operate in C++, that's what everything is really written in, and then we have this other layer on top of it in Python that it's kind of the scripting language. You know, none of the signal processing is done in Python, but you can script stuff very quickly. I love Python, I think it's a great language. And really easy to put things together quickly, and then we go down deep into C++ to get the raw speed that we need. So there are kind of two levels of the API that we expose in our manuals, and then I've got my website there that it's been dormant for a few months just because I've been so busy. But what I try to do there is keep everybody up to date on what's going on in the project. I have my own blog for when we develop new things in GNU Radio. This is how we did it. This is, you know, trying to expose stuff like that. So I think there's a couple of fun posts in there that really get to the heart of a lot of the things that we can do in GNU Radio. But as I said, there's this extra community out there, and so things with an open source project grow very, you know, kind of out of your control, and that's part of it. You know, it's We try to estimate every now and then how many people are using GNU Radio, and it's a really hard number to get. So I just recently did a few things where I was looking at downloads and various Git logs and things like that, and there's somewhere probably between 20 and 30,000 people that have downloaded GNU Radio in the past 6 months. So, but that's still very difficult to figure out who's actually in there, and that's not a bad thing. It's just a hard number to come up with. Because, you know, there are lots of interests, there are lots of places that you can go. So CGRAN is this the Comprehensive GNU Radio Archive Network, and those are where there's a lot of applications that are already written for GNU Radio. So GNU Radio is the platform, it's the development tool. People write applications on top of it, and then they post them in places like CGRAN or GitHub or some other kind of online repository like that. And then we try to have our conferences. So we're piggybacking on the DCC this year here. Our conference starts tomorrow through Thursday, and trying to, you know, kind of get the developer community together to understand who's doing what and what capabilities are out there. So that's a huge part of our project. But just going to throw some code at you right now, just to kind of get everybody prepped and primed for a little bit of what we're going to see when we go into the code. We're not going to spend too much time down on the source code level. We're going to work on top of the Python in a thing called the GNU Radio Companion. And that's a GUI interface. But underneath, this is kind of what's happening. And of course, underneath this is where the C++ happens. And we won't get there today unless we move really, really fast through the thing and people want to actually see, you know, real source code, I have no problem opening up Emacs and going into that level of detail if we want it. But what this is just showing the basic, a lot of boilerplate stuff that has to happen. Like, if you're not familiar with Python, you know, this is basically your main function, you know, void main or int main. And it's going to create what's called a top block. And that top block is kind of the instantiation of the data structure that we use called the flow graph. All right, and the flow graph is what runs the scheduler and what passes information through a system. So you have to have a source and a sink. And so in our case, we're just going to have a simulation of generating noise. So we're just going to do Gaussian noise source there. And then we're going to filter it. So we're just going to have, at the output of this thing, we're going to filter noise with an FIR filter. And in this case, a very boring example, we're going to drive it to a null sink. So basically, we're just kind of dumping into dev null. So the bits go away. But the important point here is that there are three blocks, and each one is doing something specific. So you need some way to get information into GNU Radio. In this case, we're simulating noise. And you need some way to get information out of GNU Radio. So that's part of the mandate of GNU Radio is this interaction with the outside. So, you know, you could, instead of a noise source, you should be able to hook this up to a radio. So, you know, the USERP, the EDIS research, if you're familiar with the USRP line, that's a big way of getting, transmitting and receiving data through GNU Radio. It ties in very nicely. And then getting stuff out of GNU Radio, you know, we have to do that as well. And in this case, we're just saying, well, we'll just drive it to a null sink. But that could be anything else. That you can code up to get it out there. And then there's this filtering block. And so, of course, filtering is a huge part of communications. And so, you know, do something with a filter in this case. And then we do that. You see this connect line down there. So self.connect, you know, self, it's another Pythonic thing. So if you're not familiar with Python, it's a very object-oriented language. And so self refers to the object that you're in. In this case, the class name is my top block. So when you create an object of that, it has its properties that are attached to itself. So because my top block is a child of GNU Radio, so gr.topBlock, that's the parent class, they have some methods. And one of those methods is to connect. And that's this scheduler thing. And I pull this up right now, just to kind of step back for a second. I pull this up right now just to throw something at you about what GNU Radio looks like, and then we'll pull back and we'll go over a lot of these concepts again, and then we'll see this again and again to hopefully kind of solidify in your minds what we're doing here. So the connect function there, we're actually connecting the source to the filter to the sink. So that's just creating this chain of signal processing blocks that the scheduler, that when GNU Radio is actually operated, when you hit this top block dot start down there, bits start being generated, so the noise source actually starts generating samples of noise. It's going to pass those down to the next block, which is going to filter them. It's going to pass them to the sync block. So that's all that's happening here. The other little thing that we have to show is how we create those taps. So we have a lot of tools for creating filters. And this FIRDES, so we're, you know, kind of the FIR description tool. And in this case, we're just going to generate a low-pass filter. And we'll go into a lot more detail about what those parameters mean, but you're defining the sample rate, the pass band, and the transition band between the end of the pass band and the start of the stop band. All of that's kind of encoded in there, and we'll see that a lot more. So that's what we're going to kind of be playing around with. But what's the scheduler that I'm talking about? You know, we need to make sure that the bits get there on time, and that's this is really the core of GNU Radio. This is what makes it the project that it is. And again, taking a step back to kind of explain the name of GNU Radio and that, it comes from, the reason why it's called GNU Radio, it comes from the fact that we do want to do radio communications. That was the fundamental concept of doing, of GNU Radio, was to do radio communications, wireless communications. But it doesn't stop there. You know, we actually have people ask us, well, can you do acoustic communications? Well, yeah, of course. There's really, once you're able to get the samples into GNU Radio, there's really no difference. It's signal processing. That, you know, so you can do whatever types of signals you want. There's no stopping you. So GNU Radio tends to be a little bit of a misnomer. I don't like thinking of it necessarily as GNU DSP or GNU signal processing, because that would kind of mean that it's just a toolbox of digital signal processing blocks or algorithms. And while we have that, we're not limited to that. That's not all it is, and probably that's not even the majority of what it is. The majority of what GNU Radio is the scheduler that runs underneath that moves data from sources through the blocks to the sinks. And it's complicated, it's way down deep, and nobody should ever really want to touch the scheduler, because this is Eric Blossom stuff that we're talking about here, and the guy knew his stuff when he wrote GNU Radio originally. I mean, it's a pretty ingenious construction underneath, but it's also hard, it can be fragile, because he tried to make it as optimal as possible. So general in terms of what you can do with it, and then optimal as far as speed. But that is really the core of GNU Radio. And everything else is really just kind of tied around it and hangs off it. So what is the scheduler look, what are we doing here? So we always have to have some source, some way of getting data into GNU Radio that makes sense. So, you can have more than one source as well, but we'll just look at a source. So you can have files, a microphone if you're doing audio. You can bring it in from some radio hardware, so a receiver becomes a source into a GNU Radio block. You also want to be able to tie into other programs. So if you have a network layer, if we're doing IP level networking over wireless, you want to be able to pull from the network layer, like we use just the Linux network stack is a good one, and pull those in. So we want to have some ways to tie this in with other programs and get into. So there are various levels like that we work with. And then at the other end, you need to have at least one sink, because you need someplace for those samples or those bits or packets or frames or whatever item size that you're working on. You need someplace for them to go. So again, you can drive it to a file if you want to save this for later, for post-processing, for just storage or anything. Speakers, again, if we're doing audio. Radio hardware if you're transmitting. So this is actually you push bits out to or samples out to a transmitter and get them over the air. And then GUI, so graphic user interfaces. And there's going to be a whole part of the talk just on the GUIs, because I think that this is actually very important for development of signals and debugging signal processing. But we'll see that in a second. And then in between, there's signal processing blocks. So you want to be able to process your signal in some ways. You want to multiply signals together, take the conjugates, filter, map them from bits to symbols, all sorts of things that happen there, PLLs, all sorts of like recovery loops and things like that. So you can branch this into it's really a digraph of blocks. And you can kind of conceive of putting together a huge number of solutions in this format here. The one thing that we restrict is that you can't do cycles. So you can't feedback. If you want to do feedback, you have to do that within a block. There's nothing telling you that you can't have like one sample feedback in there. But there's a good reason why we don't allow you to do it in between blocks. And it comes from this implementation of the scheduler, where you want to be, the efficiency comes from moving large chunks of data. The conception of the scheduler, where it came from, is that memory is cheap, but memory copies are expensive. And so if you're just moving one sample of memory at a time and you're constantly going through the scheduler and relaunching blocks and you're throwing up threads and all these things, that overhead is really expensive. So you wanna amortize that over a huge chunk of data. So each block from our previous look there generates a huge some n number of samples, passes those as one big chunk to the next block. And if you're doing that, if you're talking 32,000 samples or even 8,000 samples as you're moving this along, it's an efficient memory operation because you're only doing one big chunk and then you're actually processing your signal processing work on that big chunk. But from that perspective, it should be pretty obvious, I think, why we don't allow you to do cycles. Because if you're trying to do a PLL in this case, by the time your 32,000 samples pass, what does that mean for your algorithm? Now, you may be able to do some clever stuff with that, but not the traditional control loop, the ley line type stuff that you want to do. So the other thing that is hugely important to software radio is multi-rate signal processing. You have to be able to change rates, and you want to work at Nyquist as much as possible. And so we have to have some concept of rate changing. So the I/O signatures that we have for GNU Radio should allow us to play with that concept in almost any way. very standard, you know, you have one sample in, you have one sample out. So if you're just let's say inverting a signal, you know, just a one-to-one relationship, the number of samples you bring into the block are equal to the number of samples that you produce from that block. But then there are cases where you want to do interpolation or decimation, and so we have those kind of wrapped into some of the structure of GNU Radio to allow you to produce more than you've taken in, or produce fewer. So if you're decimating, you know, for every 10 samples in, you produce one sample out of your filter, so you have a 10-to-1 decimator. And then we have this arbitrary one, so you can actually play around with however many samples you pull in versus how many you produce. That's the most general case. You know, you could do everything. You know, M and N could be one. So you could conceivably do kind of any rate change relationship there. Most of the time, when you're talking about that level, though, we're talking like clock synchronizers, where you actually don't necessarily a priori have a relationship between the input to output if you're kind of playing around with these things. So we want to be able to have these rate changers, and so, you know, kind of structurally, this is actually a really good point if we wanted to dive down into the code and how it was created, because it's created from kind of a computer science data structure perspective, but it maps directly to multi-rate signal processing, and so it's that instant tie between these two fields of computer science and building the operating the GNU Radio software and the signal processing level that we were trying to accomplish with it. And this is, again, I've pointed this out before, you know, most of what our code is written, as far as the applications and as far as using GNU Radio, is done in Python. That tends to take people back sometimes. I think majority of people have gotten over that kind of instant, well, why are you running in Python? Isn't Python really slow? And the thing is, we're just using Python as the top layer, but all of the code itself is, the signal processing code is in C++ that were wrapped into Python. So we're not getting any overhead, any penalty from running in Python. We're just using it because it's a very quick scripting language. And then we have this GNU Radio Companion. This is where we're gonna be working today when everybody pulls up their systems, is the GNU Radio Companion. And this it's a graphical tool that sits on top of Python. And actually, when you use it and we create graphs, GNU Radio programs, it actually collapses down into a Python program that is then run. So it's kind of a layer on top there. Not going to talk about every single one of these, so, you know, sample as you will. Slides will be made available so you can look at this. I just want to point out that there, you know, as I said, there's the scheduler. That is the meat. That's the core of GNU Radio. But there's also a huge library of signal processing tools that we have in available for us. So there's this library of blocks. So that's what we call them in kind of our lingo. So a PLL or a Casas loop is a block that you can drop into your flow graph and do something with. And so we go, you know, we have analog, we have digital processing, signal processing, or digital modulation techniques. So OFDM is one of those. We do have, you know, we have some support for trellis coding and convolutional, so some error correction codes in there. Lots of visualization tools. So lots of various things of all types. And that's, I think, if the next one, yeah. So that's one of the kind of keys to GNU Radio is this. Is the nature, this breadth of blocks that are available, and people not necessarily knowing that they exist. You know, so there's oftentimes when people have basically recreated the same function in a block, but we decided to name it maybe a non-obvious name, and they were like, oh, well, you could have just done it with this block. And, oh, well, why didn't I know that? Well, you know, because there's a lot, and you kind of have to know what's in there. What you guys are working on right now is the 3.6 version, so the 3.6 API. This is the starting, we're moving that into 3.7, so 3.7 will hopefully be out within a couple of months, but it's a pretty big overhaul of the entire project. And one of the things that we're trying to do is split out all of these blocks, all these hundreds of blocks that we have that were, most of them were just in one big directory, and who knew it was in there. We're trying to make it a bit more obvious and a bit clearer what, where they exist and where you can find them. So if you're looking for something that's dealing with filters, you can now go into GR filter. And so the namespace changes that we're doing are partly to help us as developers, you know, keep track of things, but also to help the users who are trying to experiment and look around and get a feel for what's inside of there, be able to look at all of these kind of a bit hopefully it's a bit more obvious where things are once we go into the 3.7 API.
When you make that change from 3.6 to 3.7, does that mean that Python code that you had written in previous versions will need to be updated?
In many cases, yes. Yes. So it's this namespace change. So as you might have noticed if you've been using GNU Radio for a while, that I didn't pull the fur filter in that example. The fur filter didn't come out of gr dot, so that's a Python module, gr. That used to hold everything. If you paid attention to that example, it actually said filter dot. And so gr filter becomes a module, namespace filter. You know, there'll be a digital dot, something analog dot, you know, quadrature DMOD or whatever. So you would have to update your programs to reflect that, yeah. The C++ is going to be the harder change, though, because we're actually moving into using C++ namespaces. So that's actually going to be the more direct one. The Python is really just it's a name conversion. You know, it's really, oh, okay, my filter doesn't work anymore. Well, go change that gr to filter dot, and underneath, it'll all be the same thing. From a C++ perspective, though, there's a huge difference. And we are trying to move slowly on this. But the way that we're trying to go about this is, when we introduce gr filter, we're actually introducing gr filter in the 3.6 world. So, but we're not removing the old filter stuff. So there's kind of this duplication of code happening, but that's to help people transition over to the new blocks as they can. And then in the 3.7, we're removing that old stuff. So we're trying to provide, you know, kind of a way to help people continue to evolve with us. And I really hope this is the last major undertaking of this nature for two reasons. First one is because we don't want to keep messing with the users and forcing you to go back and redo a lot of your code. Even though, like I said, from a Python level, it really is just a name change. Like a sed script, if you're really good with sed, could probably solve most of your problems. But the other thing is we actually have to touch every single file in GNU Radio as developers. So Jonathan Corgan and I are going through every single block and file in GNU Radio to update to this. And we don't want to do that again. So for both the developers and the users, we hope this is the last major change like this. And so it only affects you guys once. And of course, you can always stick with a 3.6 API for a while until you're ready to move. Is there any other?
Maybe this is a little too specific. Do you know if there's a codec to GNU Radio module?
There is. Yes.
Oh, excellent. Yes.
Yeah, I want to say it was Tom Zode. Give him credit. I believe he did this kind of as an intern project last summer to integrate codec 2 into. So GR vocoder actually currently exists in the 3.6. You can pull it up and look at it. And I forget exactly what we have in there. We have a version of a CVSD. We have codec 2. We have an implementation of the GSM vocoder and a couple of others. I don't, Bob, do you remember any other?
It needs updating. There are many.
There are many vocoders in there, and Sue's work is the codec 2, but Rose developments of the last year are not in there. So I'll beat Tom up when I go back next week and get him to fold the latest stuff in before I sign his master's thesis.
Yeah. All right, so I mentioned before how important I think visualization is. And it's because it brings us out of this concept of just guessing what's going on with our system. It's why we have debuggers. But debugging signals can be really hard. So you have this box of GNU Radio stuff, and out of it comes garbage. And you're scratching your head going like, what, I don't understand. You can make all sorts of guesses for what's going on, but probably better if you actually are able to look inside and expose and visually see. When you're slipping every billionth sample, you're not going to want to step through GDB, even if you go through, okay, well, step a billion, if it's a billion plus or minus some million, you know, you have no idea what's happening. But when you can visually see that signal and you can see that blip on the screen, and then you could store it to a file and analyze it later, those are the types of techniques that you develop pretty quickly when you're trying to debug signal processing code. And so there's been quite a bit of an effort to work on these various graphical user interfaces. There's a lot more work that still can be done to make them even better. They're they're useful right now as debugging tools. What we want to do is have them not just as debugging tools, but also as kind of production level tools as well, that you can actually make an application, you know, full on spectrum analyzer using our QT backend. But that's the basic problem that we're trying to solve here. So here's, as I say, it's a graph that does something, but we don't necessarily know what it does or if it's working properly. And so we can throw this down. This, by the way, this is what GRC looks like. So when we start playing with this stuff on your computers, this is what we're going to be looking at, is this kind of level of, and you'll probably, it's probably familiar from kind of a Simulink or a LabVIEW type look. You know, I mean, it's inspired by those things and kind of, in some cases, the obvious representation of this flow graph. So we drop down a couple of sources. So these are just going to be generating random samples, and we're going to convert those floating point samples to a complex data stream, and then we're going to use this a resampler to resample by a factor of 4, and then, well, in this case, we're just tossing it. But we want to actually maybe see what's going on in there. So there are kind of two levels that you can do with GNU Radio. First is just drop down file syncs at various places. So I'm going to save this into, you know, input.32fc and output.32fc. And so now those are just samples of data stored in those files as we run the flow graph. And then we can pull up your favorite language. So I use Python and SciPy and Matplotlib for all of my kind of scientific and analysis programming outside of GNU Radio. And so you can easily use SciPy. The scipy.from file is an easy way to read binary data streams into data structures. And then you can do some whatever manipulations here. And then using PyLab, or that's one of the things out of this thing called Matplotlib, you can just plop down figures and then plot. So in this case, I'm just going to plot the real parts of the signal into and the signal out of that resampler block. And this is what it looks like, right? So you can, the output is was filtered and resampled, so it wasn't just, you know, kind of bits in or plus minus one samples in, filtered root race cosine samples out at a higher sampling rate. All right, so we can look at those pretty easily with these tools, and there's a handful of these plotting tools that are a part of GNU Radio right now. So these are kind of like static analysis, because that's a loaded term. But there are ways to statically visualize the signals is by using some of these tools. And one thing that's kind of common practice in GNU Radio can drive you crazy if you try to be too dogmatic about it, but these underscore F, underscore C, they try to, you know, the suffixes on blocks try to tell you what the data types that it operates on. So underscore F operates on single precision floats, and underscore C is single precision complex floats. So those are kind of overloaded to make it easier to pop up, depending on the type of signal that you use. And then again, this is, if you run the dash H for any of these programs, it'll pop up with what that information on the right side of the screen there. So you can easily see how to manipulate these things. All right, so here's an example. This is an output of, in this case, I think this is the real and imagined, yeah, it's a complex, so IQ, plot IQ plots the in-phase and quadrature components of a complex signal right on top of each other. So you see the real and the imaginary parts of a complex signal there. And you can step through it, you know, kind of, it blocks back and forth, arrow keys, buttons, and all those things. Those are just to help us visualize it in various ways. This is fairly new. What I'm trying to do is again, helping me as a developer, helping the users, is trying to collapse all of our GUI development work into kind of one area. So we use the QT backend kind of programming library, GUI programming library, and then wrap it through Python to make these things. They're very similar. I think I have an example. No, let me see. I do, yeah. In fact, let's actually pull this up on the screen here. I'll pull this up for my talk at Virginia Tech. So I should be able to just say plot. And then let's look at the PSD of, do I have my Philly station? Yeah. So I was in Philadelphia preparing for a talk, and I just put my USERP, you know, antenna near the window and grabbed 93.3 megahertz from Philadelphia up in Philly, just a strong FM signal. And you know, you can see the PSD on this on the right side here. Here is the time waveform, and you can use, you know, you can zoom in and actually start to see, you know, if you're good out there, you're probably decoding the FM in your head right now. And they're tied together, you know, as I zoom in here, you can see the PSD also zooms to just be plotting what's on the left side there. And then, as I said, you know, we can step through these things. And you can see the digital modulation on the side there and the analog one sitting in the middle there. But that's, and I'll pull that up again, because there is some neat stuff that one can do with visualizing the signals. And we'll be playing around a lot with that when we're kind of going through the exercises that we'll go through later. Yeah, back here. So again, you know, you can plot the constellation. So it just gives you the polar coordinate plot of the INQ. The PSDs, you can just plot them in time. And then there's kind of interactions that you can use with the menu now to kind of help us. So this is the way that we do statically. Here's again some of the options that you can send to it if you want to change the defaults for how many samples you read in, how many kind of where you start in the file. All those things, and probably more, should be flexible. As I said, this is kind of a work in progress. This is just from a couple months ago, kind of integrating that in there. But they make fairly nice graphs that you can manipulate in a lot of fun and interesting ways. So that's helpful. Now, that's the static thing. So that's if you drag something to a file and you want it to look at it later. All right. Often, I find it more useful to dynamically view things as things are running through my system, and so that's what the GUIs are designed for. So the Qt GUIs are the old ones, WX. So you can actually run these things while it's live. You can see these things streaming across. So there's the input, there's the output, and I'm going to try and hope this thing behaves for me. So this is GNU Radio Companion, and I'm just going to essentially recreate what we saw there. Hopefully you can see this well enough. So what we're going to do, and this is kind of stuff that we're going to walk through, and feel free to kind of follow along now, but I'm going to walk through one kind of from scratch developing a system to view in front of you right now. So one thing is that there's a couple of GUI backends. There's one based in WXPython. The other one is based using the Qt library. I generally prefer the Qt library. It's not necessarily as full featured, but I think it's nicer looking. I think it performs better. And so you have to switch the backend basically to tell it use in the options block. Tell it to use Qt instead, and then. To make it simple, I'm just going to drop down our first example here. So I'll try to announce what I'm putting down if you can't see it from the back, because I know it's pretty small. And unfortunately, there's no way to increase the font size in this program. Again, in the break, I'll see if I can actually just change the resolution of my screen to help you guys out when we get back, when we break. So anyways, what I'm doing here is dropping down a noise source. And if you double click on anything, it pops up the properties boxes where you can set various parameters and change stuff and see what it's actually supposed to be doing. So in this case, you can change the output type. So it's a source, so it only has output ports. And in this case, so it's complex, and you can choose the type. The color of the port out there is actually indicative of the data type. Yeah? Yeah,
it's a little bit hard to read.
I understand that. I'm not going to do it right now because that's almost certain to take down the entire system. I'm going to wait till the break, and then so that's why I'm trying to announce what's going on here. So we're going to talk about a complex system. There's various types of PSDs. So we're just going to PDFs. So we're just going to generate Gaussian samples. There's amplitude that you can set to change the amplitude of the signal, and a seed. So this is just like a random seed that you can put in. We'll just say zero for default, so it's going to be whatever it is. All right. All these blocks on the side, again, hopefully after when we break, I'll fix this and we can read it better. But all these blocks on the side are kind of components that house things of like nature. So what I brought down up here was the sources. So there's all sorts of sources that you can pull in. Here I'll pull up the sink. And so our sink, again, we're just gonna, this is that null sink. So we're not gonna actually do anything with the bits right now. And then there's a filter component on the side here. And I'm gonna pull up an FFT filter is an implementation of a FIR filter. And I'm going to say, again, don't worry about this right now. We'll go over this more later. I'm just gonna plop down a low pass filter. So we're just gonna be sampling our, filtering our noise. So I'm gonna do that, and I'm gonna pass a kilohertz with a fairly small transition band. Okay. And then what you do is you click on one port, output port into an input port, and it creates the connection there, and do the same. So now we have, that's our flow graph. And what you saw, if you can see it, hopefully the colors show up, is these are in red. And so what that's telling you is that there's an error. So something isn't right. And you can click on this red symbol up there, and it'll tell you what those errors are. And to read it for you, essentially it's telling me that the FFT filter does not have its output port connected, and that the null sink does not have its input port connected. So these are hints for what's going wrong. And in this case, I just need to tie those two together. Red's gone. We now have a system we can work with. So save that as a file. And when we run this thing, nothing happens because we're just generating noise and dropping it to a sink. But when we want to see what's going on here, we can actually plop down our Qt GUI, our Qt GUI sinks, tie this in here, and then when we visualize it, now we can look at the signal operating, and then you can look at it in various dimensions. So there's time, and you can just look at the real part or real and imaginary part together. You can look at the IQ plot of this guy or the polar plot of a noise source, which is kind of cool. And then there's the we have the spectrogram as well.
You can see here, hidden behind the scenes, is some fairly good smarts. When Tom put the parameters up there, it automatically determined the filter size and how to glue it all together. So all that's automated and behind the scenes, which is part of the great thing that's happened with GNU Radio Companion, is you give it a little performance spec and it does all the hard work for you.
So what we saw before, when I had my really simple example of this, there was a lot of boilerplate stuff and things of that nature. This does that for you. This, you're just working on the blocks and you're just kind of focused on getting your flow graph up and running, as opposed to worrying about the kind of the language issues. Leave that to guys developing it. All right, so we'll break out of there. And we'll try not to go back too much into there until I can fix the resolution issue. We have some time. So, well, before we move on to the next section, so that's, any questions about the, great.
Could you talk briefly about how powerful a computer and what features it needs to run this? How much memory? I heard about CUDA.
Let's see. That's a really hard question to answer, actually, because GNU Radio is designed to be real time for your definition of real time. But of course, that is directly impacted by how fast your computer is, what architecture you have. You know, if you're running a Centrino, you're going to be crippled because of your cache and the architecture changes of the Centrino versus a Pentium Xeon, which, you know, is going to give you a huge amount of a leg up. But honestly, like, when to run this particular example that I put up there, the sampling rate was only 32K. So that's kind of the default. When you pop up GNU Radio Companion, it wants to operate at 32 kilosamples per second. This, let's see, I'm trying to find a way to answer that question. Because, as I said, it's really depending on what you're trying to do. This thing would run on a 10-year-old computer, because GNU Radio actually was started in 2001. And a lot of these things, you know, doing the analog communication system, so AM, FM, those types of things, you know, you're talking about built and designed and operated on a 10-year-old machine at that point. And we haven't changed the underlying architecture that much. In fact, there was one significant change to the scheduler that we made that added logic to the system, and I was afraid that we were going to negatively impact everybody else, and it turned out that my changes made it even more efficient. I think I'm handling cache better in some ways. It's a bizarre result, but one that I was very happy with. So I think we're doing better in you know, slightly better, only a couple percentage points better than we were. So as I said, a 10-year-old computer can do a lot for you. What you'll see, and I do actually have a figure of this. I'll try to find it at some point. If you're doing, say, the digital modulation scripts, so we have a couple of canned examples just to kind of show you how to put together a digital modulation transmitter and receiver that does something like, let's just say, QPSK. And you want to run your QPSK system over the air and receive it. And so the receiver is doing all the recovery loops, you know, timing and frequency and phase correction, all those types of things, and filters and all of that. The speed that you can run that, the number of, like, the kilosamples, kilobits per second of your digital modulation signal, that's going to completely depend on your system, your architecture, you know, how fast you are, how big your cache is. All of those things are going to impact it. So you could go from 50 kilobits per second up to, you know, 50 megabits per second, but that 50 megabit per second that's going to be a heck of a machine. But your 50 kilobit per second, almost anything could probably run that. So it'll be interesting to see with people here as we're going to go through some of our examples with the various netbooks to you know, Macs and those types of things to see what we'll see. But there, so I'm really dancing around this question.
Let me give an example.
So the graduate student whose master's thesis I'm going to threaten just did for the OMAP 3530, which is a Beagle board or the E100.
It's an ARM processor based.
Yeah, it's just the processor. It's a processor. And it's an ARM. And it's, you know, a few hundred megahertz. It's no big deal. He did a full GSM base station in the E100 and on the Beagle board, right, and do an order of magnitude 10 handsets running through the base station. So the code is highly optimized. There's been a lot of work done on the mathematical optimization of GNU Radio, where it determines the fancy hardware you have in your computer and optimizes the performance of the code for your computer. All the SIMD stuff on ARM and Intel and those things are all utilized, and we're about to take off into fancier devices. But for right now, all of the computers you have on your desk, it goes, it looks at what you have, it optimizes the code for your computer. But as always, if you have 80 cores, you can do a lot. But if you have one old core, you can't do so much.
Yeah, that pulls up in my mind a couple of things to point out about the scheduler itself. So the original scheduler, every block was run in a single thread. And what we changed a couple of years ago, what Eric did a couple of years ago, was change it to a thread per block. So every time we put a block down on that graph there, it's now operating in its own thread. So we're now parallelizing over all of this, whatever your computer can handle. So if you have an 80-core machine, or you have an 80-thread type machine, and you have 80 blocks, each one of those is now operating on its own CPU. And so the speed up that you get for the number as you add more processors, Eric was really good. It's pretty close to linear. So all of those things are go into that kind of understanding. Memory, you do need a pretty significant amount of memory. But again, from 10 years ago, you know, we're talking, you know, megabytes on your you know, to a gigabyte type, not even a gigabyte, megabytes. You know, it's not, we know the memory's there, we know memory's cheap, but it doesn't have to have, you know, top of the line computer today to run a lot of this stuff. Yeah.
Are there modules for traditional ham radio digital modes like PSK31, which is very popular?
There are, and you'll find those in that CGRAN that I mentioned. Because here's one of the the things, and it's been a design choice, and there's been thoughts whether or not it was the right one or should we correct it. But as we said, GNU Radio really is the platform, the development tool used to build applications like PSK31 or, you know, any of those, any like digital modes or even analog modes. There are some analog mode applications for amateur radio communications that come as part of GNU Radio. But the other things you'll find as people who built off of GNU Radio and their own kind of external module and external application that links and uses GNU Radio as its base, as its scheduler in the core, but they've done all the application stuff. So we try to kind of position ourselves as a development platform, and then if you want to write an application, you write it, you put it in cGRN. So that's another really nice feature of GNU Radio, is this ability to do external projects that link against GNU Radio and use it, but don't always have to be directly tied underneath there. So you can create your own out-of-tree projects really easily and link it very nicely. So yeah, I know I don't have a list of all the projects on cGRN off the top of my head, but I know somebody has done PSK31, and I'm trying to think of any others that I know off the top of my head. I was trying to think of the amateur radio, so GPS, AIS, ADB, ADSB has been done, and I think we're going to see actually that in our conference.
DVB is about there.
DVB has a lot of work on that. So Digital Radio Mondial, so DRM, the European standard. The receivers for that have been done in various incarnations in GNU Radio over the past few years. A student out of Karlsruhe was just funded by the Google Summer of Code to create a DRM transmitter in GNU Radio. So lots of things out there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I just want to say very briefly that the same CPU problem that you have with this is the problem we have in PowerSDR. People ask us all the time, how much do I need? And I don't think you can underestimate the importance of cache. Cache is really, really important as you're running gobs and gobs of samples through the CPU doing operations on it. And there's a thing that happens in PowerSDR sometimes where people will add one more thing or do one extra thing, and all of a sudden the CPU jumps up very sharply, which is because now they're overflowing the cache. And that's something probably that's a useful tip for people running this. If you see the CPU jump up sharply when you've done something you don't think should do that, it may be that you're overflowing the cache at that point.